Now to the standard definition of the correlation. Let's say you have a set of measurements of x and y values, and we ask if they are related to each other. What this means is, if we pick a high x value, does this mean that the y value that comes with it is also high, or is it low, or does the value of the x value has no correlation or association to the y value? So what does related mean? Let's look, for example, at a general model where we model our data as a bivariate or joint Gaussian of a correlation coefficient rho. The formula is given here on the slide. This term you know from the univariate Gaussian, which is then divided by 2 times sigma x. And we have here this normalization factor that normalizes the distribution to 1. Now we are in the bivariate case, so similarly to the deviation of our x from the mean x, we have also a deviation of the y from the mean y. And then we have a third term here in the exponential that mixes the deviation from x and from y and normalizes them to the respective standard deviations. And we have this prefactor rho, which is the correlation coefficient and also appears here in the normalization and here. If rho is 0, this means very little correlation. So looking back at the formula, so in case rho is 0, this means this term disappears. This parentheses are just 1, so it disappears, and this also disappears, and we are left with the standard bivariate Gaussian of uncorrelated x and y. If rho is close to 1, then this becomes a very small number, which makes this whole exponential larger. You have to be careful because, of course, this can also be then, this has here a negative sign. So if the deviation of x values and the deviation of y values are in opposite direction, this increases the value here of the parenthesis. In the figure on the left, I show the contours of a bivariate Gaussian in case our rho is close to 0. So we have unrelated data. And this is also the figure here on the right. We see the standard bell-shaped curve. Picking any x value does not favor larger or smaller y values. And the probability is just limited by the distance from the common mean or the center of the bell shape. The red curve shows the contours of equal probability for a very large correlation coefficient. And we see that when we pick a high x value, this also means that we have a high y value and opposite. So we have no contours here. And this is the corresponding three-dimensional shape. When we look at this from the side, it looks like a one-dimensional Gaussian. This is always important to note. Also, the three-dimensional Gaussian is in projection, again, always a Gaussian. And here projection also, of course, means integrating along one dimension, which is called marginalization. And we are left with a Gaussian with fewer dimensions. The parameter rho is the correlation coefficient and is formally given by the covariance of the x and the y data vectors normalized by the standard deviation of x and y. When we have a sample, so a finite set of x values and related y values, xi and yi, then the correlation is computed by summing up the product of the x and y deviation for every data point, and then dividing by the standard deviation of x and the standard deviation of y. Note that the factors 1 over n cancel out because they appear in the covariance and also in the standard deviation. Since we are here looking at the sample, we call this R, which is also called the Pearson product moment correlation coefficient of the sample in this case. We saw in the previous plot the contour, in the previous slide the contour plots of the bivariate Gaussians, and the contours I drew will have dropped by 1 over e from the value at the origin when we reach these conditions. In matrix notation, this can also be written like this, and we have a matrix here that only depends on the variances in x and y and the covariance and the covariance term and the correlation coefficient. The inverse of this central matrix is the covariance matrix, sometimes also called error matrix. We call it sigma here, and the elements on the diagonal are the variances, and the off-diagonal elements are the of the covariance matrix can be estimated by the covariance formula given here. Again, we sum up the products of all the x and y deviations. So this should actually be a y here. We are looking at the sample covariance, so we have this Bessel-corrected value here. When we look at population correlations and covariances, then we use 1 over n. So the covariance is a measure of how much two random variables change together. If the greater values of one variable mainly corresponds with the greater value of others, and the same holds for the smaller values, then we have a positive covariance. Yeah, looking back at the formula, when we have a large x value, which that means that the deviation from the mean is positive, and if this also comes with a large y value, which means that the deviation of the y value from the y mean is also positive, then we multiply two positive numbers, which gives us a larger positive number. Let's say we have a large x value that always correlates with a very low y value, then we multiply the positive deviation with the negative y deviation, which gives us a large negative value, and therefore for a negative correlation coefficient, or in this case, covariance. In contrast to the correlation coefficient, we have the covariance not limited by plus and minus 1, and the magnitude is not easy to interpret. So the normalized version, which is the correlation coefficient, shows by its magnitude the strength of the linear relation. Just a very, very simple numerical example. Let's take three data points and compute the corresponding correlations and covariances. So we first have to compute the mean x and the mean y value. So we take all the x values, 0, 2, and 10, and compute the mean, which is 4, and then we take the mean of the y values, which is also 4. With the mean values, we can now compute the standard deviations. Let's say this is our population, so we divide by 3, and then we can compute here the squared deviations and add them up. So the deviation from 4 is 4, 2, and 6, which has to be squared, gives us 4.32 as the standard deviation in x, and we do the same in y, where we have a standard deviation of 3.74. We are inconsistent here because we now use the Bessel-corrected covariance. This is just a prefactor, so let's ignore this for the moment. The covariance is now computed with... Well, that's not inconsistent because this is the mean... No, this is correct. This should be also then 3 minus 1. The covariance now is the sum of the deviation product bit of x and y, which is given here, gives us 24. Now let's change our data. Let's from 10.9 go to 10.0. So here on the bottom left is the plot of the first data set, and the bottom right is the second data set. And if you by eye would draw a line through them, you would have an increasing line on the left and a decreasing line on the right. So we have a negative association or correlation in this data. And this is because the 9 here reduces, and the 0 instead of the 9 reduces the mean value. And we now have different deviations, a smaller standard deviation in y. And we have here, for example, a negative times a positive. So we have a large negative value here, which makes the covariance negative in this data point. Okay. We were looking at the bivariate Gaussian, and as a little side chapter, let's look how can we generate numbers, random numbers, that obey a bivariate Gaussian distribution with a given standard deviation and given correlation coefficients. So we work backwards, basically, through what we saw earlier. We set up our error matrix with the variances in x and y on the diagonal elements and the inverse elements here. We compute the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of this matrix, which creates a transformation matrix that diagonalizes the covariance matrix using the eigenvectors as column vectors. And we will see later that this transforms our distribution into an uncorrelated data set, and we can now sample from the individual Gaussian distributions and then retransform our uncorrelated x and y pairs using our transformation matrix back to the correlated one. We will see in a minute how this is also applied in the principal component analysis. And here in the figure, I show you the result for two different values of rho. X of continuous variables, this distribution is given by this expression. It is convenient to move to the matrix notation as we saw in the bivariate case. So we can express the exponential here with the transpose of the x vector minus the mean vector times the inverse of the covariance matrix and times the deviation vector again. And this has to be normalized with the corresponding factors. Note that the dimension also goes here into the power of the 2 pi factor. So mu is the mean vector of our data. This is a d by d matrix. That is the covariance matrix. And this is the determinant of sigma. One very convenient and important property of the multivariate Gaussian distribution is that if two sets of variables are jointly Gaussian, then the conditional distribution of one set conditioned on the other is again a Gaussian. Similarly, the marginal distribution, so the integral with respect to some of the variables, is of either set is also Gaussian. So suppose x is a d-dimensional vector with a Gaussian distribution, as shown on the previous slide, distributed given a certain mean vector and covariance matrix. And let's say we partition our x vector into two subsets, xA and xB. So xA and xB are two x vectors, so we partition the total x, which also gives us the partitioned means. And we just arrange it such that xA is the first m components of x and xB is the remaining d minus m component. Then we can write down the covariance matrix of a sigma also in terms of these partitioned sub-matrices, sigma AA, sigma BB, and sigma AB and BA. The inverse of the covariance matrix, another name is the precision matrix, and since it's a symmetric, and since the inverse of a symmetric matrix is also symmetric, we see that when we look here, this is the inverse, we call it lambda, which can be correspondingly also written as this partitioned matrix. And we see that these two need to be symmetric as well, while for the off-diagonal elements, we find that AB is the transpose of BA. Please be aware that this is not simply the inverse of the sub-sigma matrix AA. But it turns out that the expression for the conditional probability of the xA vector given nxB can be written as is again a Gaussian with x distributed according to this mean vector mu A given B and the inverse of just this submatrix. And mu AB can be computed from our initial mu A minus the mu AB times the inverse lambda AB times the inverse of lambda AA times XB minus mu B, which can also be written like this. And the sigma AB can be written, the sigma A given B can be written like this. So we see that a joint distribution is Gaussian, then the conditional distribution is again a Gaussian. And this means that also the marginal distribution is a Gaussian. And without derivation, when we write down the marginal distribution, so we take the joint distribution of Pxa and Xb and integrate over all possibilities of Xb, we are left with the unconditional marginal distribution of Pxa, which has a mean value mu A and a covariance given by sigma AA. So for the marginal distribution, they are expressed in the terms of the partition covariance matrix. Let's take a closer look on how to interpret the covariance matrix. When you recall our initial figures on correlation, we are describing the strength of a linear correlation. The strength of a linear correlation is geometrically can be interpreted as how close our data sticks to a line. If they are widely distributed, we have a weak correlation. And if they are sticking closely to the line, we have a strong correlation. And looking at the variance is a measure of how our data spreads. So for example, for this data point, the variance in X corresponds to the spread in X direction, and the variance in Y corresponds to the spread in Y direction. So we are talking always of the spread of data in directions that are parallel to our coordinate system, to our feature space. The diagonal spread is the one that is captured by the covariance, actually. So in this example, the covariance is a measure of how much the data spreads here in the red direction and in the y direction. Looking at the covariance matrix, we have the variance in X, which is this number, the variance in Y, which is this number, and we have the covariance of XY, which is the variance, the dependence of the XY values. Now, what is the geometric correspondence of these arrows that I draw here? If X is positively correlated with Y, and Y, then Y is also positively correlated with X. So the covariance XY is the same as the covariance YX, which makes a covariance matrix always symmetric. And the covariance matrix defines the shape of the data. Now let's imagine that we perform a rotation on our data. So we swap or rotate our coordinate system. In this particular case, we start by the bottom left figure and we rotate it by, let's see, by 90 degrees. And I, in the bottom right, I give the covariance matrix of the rotated data set. So when we rotate by 90 degrees, we see that the variances in x and y exchange places. We basically exchange the x and y values. And we saw that the off-diagonal elements remain the same in magnitude, but have now a negative sign, which is clear because we swapped the covariance behavior. So a large x now corresponds to a low y. Rotation of our data in the feature space changes the covariance matrix element because we change the individual deviations of every data point from x and y. What we can do is, look, we moved from very large, from large to negative covariance elements. We can find a certain rotation angle that sets the covariance elements to zero. This is the bottom left, an example, and there's a second possibility on the bottom right, which is the bottom left case rotated by 90 degrees. Now, when we look at the bottom left, our variance, an x, is the spread in x, and the variance here is the spread in y of our data. So by rotation, we changed the variance entries, and on the rotated case, we have this behavior swapped. So we rotated our data such that now the variance in x is minimal. Because you can imagine if we rotate the bottom left data set somewhat more to positive or negative angles, this will increase the spread in x. So by this rotation, we found a coordinate transform that minimizes the spread in one dimension and maximizes the spread in the other dimension. And now our data can be described by just two numbers because the covariance is zero. And the arrows that I draw here in the figures correspond to the vectors that are built by the columns, by the rows, not by the columns, by the rows of the covariance matrix. Though the first row of the covariance matrix here corresponds to an 1.47 in y direction and 0 in x direction and 0 in y direction. So that's the green arrow. The direction here is arbitrary, so we have to choose either side. And 5.84 is the length of this arrow, which goes in the y direction. And consequently, also these two vectors are made up by the eigenvectors of the covariance matrix. We can also look at partial correlation, in which we just look at the correlation between two variables in a multidimensional set and by nullifying the effect of a third variable upon the variables being considered. And here I just as an brief example, show you how this is done for a three-dimensional and a four-dimensional case. And we can also generalize this . So if you need the partial correlation, this is just for you as a reference here. We can also look at a special case of the correlation where we don't not have a collection of x and y values, for example, so two data vectors that we want to compare to each other. But when we want to compare one vector with itself. And this is called autocorrelation, so the correlation of a data set with itself. And it's a measure of the internal, can be used as a measure of the internal correlation, for example, within a time series. Let's look at the data. This is measles and chickenpox, registered in England and Wales as a weekly number from 1948 to 1967. We clearly see that there is a periodic behavior. So every about 2 years, we have a strong outbreak of measles and chickenpox and very few cases in between. So you might ask, take an arbitrary spot in time. On the average, what does the time series will look like in 4 weeks' time compared to now? So you are asking about how strong is the internal association within the series at a period of 4 weeks. That could be very strong and positive. So which means in 4 weeks we will have the same data or similar data as we have today. Or it can be very strong and negative, which means very dissimilar, or there could be no relationship. In this particular case, let's say we are in the spring of the year or in winter 1955, we find that when we move 2 years ahead, we will again have similar numbers to what we have in 1955, but in 1 year time, we will have very different numbers. And this is computed here in this figure. What we have on the x-axis is a shift in weeks. And so we have here 50 weeks. This is how the data correlates to itself if we move 50 weeks ahead. And what we do is we take this data, we duplicate it, shift it by 50 weeks to the right, and then for every data point we take the product of the two and sum up over all data points. If we shift it such that one peak falls on top of the other peak and low peaks fall on top of low peaks, we get to some very large numbers. When we shift it such that high peaks fall on low numbers and low peaks fall on high numbers, we add up many low magnitude values and get a small value. And this is shown here, where we find for a shift or time lag of about 105 weeks, so pretty exactly 2 years, a maximum. So we find a 2 year periodicity of measles infection based on the autocorrelation of our data. This can be also used in two-dimensional or multi-dimensional cases where we could then, for example, look at how certain spatial scales dominate, for example, an image or two-dimensional or higher dimensional data. Formally, the autocovariance describes the variance between values of a stochastic process, so of a measurement at different times. So instead of x and y, we have now x at time 1 and x at time 2. The correlation coefficient is defined as the normalized auto covariance, and in from signal theory we can see that it can be computed like this. So the product of x at a time t with x at a shifted time t over all times.